What I want to do this morning is kind of a brief recap of the storyline. We've been looking since March at the story, but in doing that, I really want to focus on the major covenants that you see in Scripture that God entered into with people in the unfolding of this story. So it'll be a recap, but there's going to be a focus now on the covenants as God enters into them with people in the unfolding of the story. Now, Scripture begins with God creating everything over 6 days in the beginning, and that takes us back to the first class in March. And as it originally came from the hand of God, creation is pronounced, Genesis 1:31, is very good. Humans were created uniquely in the image of God, and they were given a place of special importance in the purposes of God. They are God's representatives. And part of that specialness is included in that is they're given the authority to rule over the earth. It was an idyllic and a blessed existence in which all things were functioning in harmony and in peace and in accordance with the will of God. There was no death. And Adam and Eve, the first humans, they were in harmony with God, they were in harmony with each other, and they were in harmony with all of creation. This is how creation is given to us from God. And the term covenant, what I want to be focusing on as we go through this, the term covenant, it carries with it the idea of pact or agreement. And when a covenant was made between unequals in the ancient world, when that was the case, the superior party typically promised blessings and protection, and the inferior party to the covenant pledged loyalty and submission. Covenants were common. You could see that, for instance, if the Assyrians entered into a covenant with a vassal nation, well, the Assyrian would promise blessings and protection, and the vassal nation would promise loyalty and submission. Now, the word covenant doesn't appear. It's not used in the Bible until you get to the story of Noah. In Genesis chapter 6, verse 18, that's the first appearance. But despite that, there are reasons to think that there's a covenant between God and Adam as a representative of the human race and God and all creation through Adam. There are reasons for thinking there's a covenant there so that God deals with creation, all of creation, on the basis of how he deals with mankind. That's why that there's this connection between us and mankind. And some of the reasons for thinking that is that the elements of God's providing, his sustaining, and his blessing and mankind's duty of faithful submission, along with you have these specified sanctions or punishments for disobedience. All of that smells like a lord-vassal covenant from the ancient world. So even though the term is not used, there's at least a good case to be made that there was in fact a covenant between God and Adam and God and creation through Adam. Now, you could argue about that. But when Adam and Eve rejected God's rule by disobeying God, his very good creation, it was corrupted or spoiled or tainted. Humans were alienated from God and from each other, and also were alienated from creation as a result of God's cursing the ground so that it would now be in rebellion to mankind as mankind was in rebellion to God. So you have these tremendous consequences as a result of this sin. And as the Spirit makes clear much later through the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 8, you see that the effect of the fall was cosmic in scope. It wasn't simply the land here, it was cosmic in scope. All of creation was subjected to futility and subjected to the bondage of corruption. That is why all of creation, which is tied to God's dealing with humanity, it awaits our redemption because it shares in that. Now, in the midst of this bad news, sin being brought in, this very good creation being spoiled or corrupted, in the midst of that bad news, there's this ray of hope that comes very early in Scripture. In Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, what is called sometimes the proto-evangelium, this first gospel, where you have this hint very early on in Genesis 3:15, where in the last clause it speaks of one man, singular. It speaks of one man who's a descendant of Eve, so this is a human. Okay, it's going, of course, it's the God-man. But it speaks of one man, a descendant of Eve, who will strike or bruise the serpent. Your is singular. He and your, the serpent's head, and the conflict that's playing out. You see, the conflict that is here with the introduction of sin, where the serpent draws into the human stream this sin that is corrupting God's creation. Well, this conflict that's playing out, it ends with Christ, the God-man, prevailing over Satan, who's the fallen spirit being who animated the serpent in the garden. So here early in Genesis 3:15, you get this glimpse, this picture, this little veiled kind of illusion of where is it going to end? How is it going to work out? Noah, so here we have this covenant, arguably a covenant, though debatable, with God and Adam and all of creation. And Noah's introduced through the genealogy in Genesis chapter 5 as a descendant of Adam through Seth. And then in chapter 6, we see that the sin that Adam let loose on the human society and human world, it has thoroughly corrupted God's very good creation. You see the extent to which this corruption has taken hold, so that the Lord says the things that he says there in those texts in Genesis 5 and 6, Genesis 6, 5 and 6, Genesis 6, 11 and 12. You see what has happened, how it has grown and intensified and magnified and spread like a cancer that's destroying the creation. And this is, it's introduced and then it does this. It has this effect. And when we taught this in March, we kind of walked through and watched the intensification and the spreading. Now, God justly and rightly brought a cataclysmic flood through which he destroyed the earth, and he killed everything on dry land in whose nostrils was the breath of life. And you see that in Genesis 7:22. Now, he had mercy on Noah. He calls Noah in advance. He has mercy on Noah and on those seven other members in his family and representatives, the breeding pairs of the various kinds of land animals and birds. They all escaped this cataclysmic judgment through the mercy of God. God was right and just in destroying the world with a global flood. But in his mercy, he preserved Noah and the seven others in his family and those breeding pairs of the land animals and birds. Now, afterward, you have the sacrifice after the flood. God established a covenant with Noah. Now, there's a question here. Is this a reassertion of the prior covenant that God had with creation through Adam, or is it a new covenant? And there's a good case to be made that it is a reassertion of a prior covenant, because he doesn't use the terminology cut a covenant, which is typical when you're entering into a new covenant, creating a new covenant. So you have some of these signals that perhaps this is in fact the reassertion of a prior covenant. But God makes a covenant or established a covenant with Noah and with all the creatures that were with him on the ark. With all the creatures that were with him on the ark. You see that in Genesis 9, 9, and 10. And he establishes that covenant, promising that he would never again bring a global flood. And so if this is a reassertion of the prior covenant, how does it work out? Well, it's possible. Peter Gentry and Stephen Wellum, two scholars, they argue in their book, Kingdom Through Covenant, that the covenant with Noah, that it's not entirely new, but it's this reassertion of this prior covenant that God had made with creation through Adam. And it's this covenant. And that covenant that he'd made with Adam, it included implicitly a commitment that was conditioned on mankind's faithfulness, but it included a commitment on God's part to preserve and protect the creation as part of the overall blessing of mankind. And the flood was a judgment that was brought on all the earth. It was brought on, though, by mankind's wickedness, mankind's rebellion against God, mankind's rejection of the covenant. So God is in a covenant to preserve and protect and bless creation, implicit in his blessing of mankind, but he destroys the earth because mankind isn't faithful. Mankind is in rebellion to God. So what is this reassertion of this covenant? Well, it is a covenant that God reasserts with creation, Noah, and all of the critters coming off. He reasserts it, but now there's this refinement to it. Well, what is the refinement? The refinement is that even though man be wicked, and you see that in chapter 8, verse 21, even though man is inclined toward evil from his youth, despite that, I will never again destroy the earth with a global flood. You see, so now the commitment to creation is refined to the point that, yes, they violated the covenant and were wicked, and I destroyed the creation in this global flood. And yes, their mind is committed toward evil always, but I am in my commitment to creation never again going to destroy it with a global flood. That's how I think that, you know, at least it's a possible way of looking at how it can be a reassertion of the prior covenant. Or if you just want to think of it, no, this is the first covenant that we have in the Bible. God makes this covenant with Noah. But the point is, his covenant and his commitment is he will no longer destroy the earth through a global flood, having just done that. It is because of his mercy, he says, in his commitment to his creation, that he's not going to do that. Now, so despite our ongoing wickedness, you see, or we'd have had flood after flood, wouldn't we? We'd have had flood, but God said, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that again. Well, given that sin passed through the flood in the persons of Noah and his relatives, some kind of extraordinary work was going to be necessary to heal the sin-sick world, to heal the broken world, the broken creation, that it might be all that God intends it to be. Some kind of extraordinary work was going to be required. And that work begins to take shape in the calling of Abram, later Abraham, of course, but of calling Abram in Genesis chapter 12. God calls this man Abraham, and he enters into a covenant with him wherein he promises to bless Abraham with a multitude of descendants, a multitude of descendants living securely in a bountiful homeland, see, which serves as a type. It serves as a type of redeemed creation. But he promises Abraham that he'll have a multitude of descendants living securely in a bountiful homeland, and he promises to bless all nations of the earth through him. All nations of the earth through him. So this veiled statement that you saw in Genesis 3:15, this little signal that you saw of what was going to come, that a man, a descendant of Eve, would win the ultimate victory over Satan, that promise, that illusion, it's now narrowed down by God's election of Abraham. Of all the people of all the nations that they're there, that are on this planet, God says here to Abraham that this Messiah, this one who's announced in Genesis 3:15, the one who's going to bless the world through the defeat of Satan, that this one is going to come through the lineage of Abraham. All of these people, Genesis 3:15, there's going to be this one, this descendant of a woman who's going to crush the one who's animating the serpent in the garden and win this ultimate victory? Coming through Abraham. Through your offspring will all the nations of the world be blessed. And of course, that line, it's further traced through Abraham's son Isaac, and then through Isaac's son Jacob, who's also called Israel, and through Jacob's son Judah, and later through, I'm going to say in a minute, through Judah's descendant, King David. So you have all of this narrowing that goes on in who is going to be this one, this descendant of the woman, who is going to win this ultimate victory. Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Judah, David. And so it gets narrowed down and comes this way. Now Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 16, that the promises were spoken, he says, to Abraham and to his seed. And then he parks on the fact that seed is singular. Now, he knows very well that seed can be a collective because he uses it in a collective sense in 3:29. But he draws significance from the fact that it is singular. And he says here that the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed, the singular form of which Paul says under inspiration identifies Christ as being in some sense the descendant of Abraham to whom the covenant blessings were promised. The promises were made to Abraham and to his seed, singular. They were made to Abraham and to Christ. You see, and the implication of that, the implication is that, and it's the one that Paul's making in Galatians, is that one only shares in the blessings of the Abrahamic promise. One only shares and receives the blessings of that promise through one's relationship with Jesus, through one's identification with the seed. You see, so we become in Christ's lineage through faith in him. You see, that's where the promise comes through. He's the seed. And so that's the point that Paul is making there in Galatians chapter 3. Now, it's through faith in Christ. It's through trusting God's testimony about who Jesus is that one imitates the faith of Abraham, right? He believed God. And so when God comes and says, I'm telling you, this is who Jesus is. He is my one and only son. This is who he is, what he's doing, and we believe that. You see, so it is in believing God's testimony about who Jesus is that one imitates the faith of Abraham and thus becomes what? One of Abraham's sons or daughters, heirs of the promised inheritance. You see, so Abraham is here, the seed Christ is here. Through faith in him, we become sons and daughters. So he is the seed, and through faith in him, we become part of Abraham's seed collectively. So that we then, through Christ, the seed, we participate in the blessings that God promised to Abraham. And so this is what Paul says in Galatians. So Christ is the procurer and the portal of the promised blessings. He's the one through whom all the nations of the world are blessed. He's the one where everybody, whatever nation, Gentiles all over, he's the one through faith in him. He's the portal of Abrahamic sonship because he is the seed. And so when Paul makes that, now you see this in Galatians, for example, in Galatians chapter 3, verses 6 through 9, and chapter 3, verse 29. And here you see, consider Abraham. He believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. You know then that those of faith are sons of Abraham. Well, I'm not in Abraham's biological lineage, but he says, those who are of faith are sons of Abraham because we are imitators of Abraham's faith and that we believe what God has said about Jesus. So he says they're sons of Abraham. And the scripture foreseeing that God would pronounce the Gentiles righteous by faith declared the gospel beforehand to Abraham, saying, all the nations will be blessed in you. Okay, that's where it's at. This is back in Genesis 12. All the nations will be blessed through you. Gospel, what's that about? That's about Jesus, the seed. All the nations will be blessed through you. Through you, through Jesus, who is the procurer and the portal of stepping into the promises of Abraham. So this is the Abrahamic covenant that we see fulfilled, and of course, fulfilled in Jesus. So then, those of faith are blessed along with Abraham, the man of faith, and in verse 29, and if you belong to Christ, then you are Abraham's seed. You see, Paul's aware of the collective sense. You are Abraham's seed. Why? Because of your connection with the seed. So this is what Paul says there. Now, the coming of Jesus is connected to the Abrahamic covenant. You see it in Luke 1, 54 and 55. That's in Mary's song. You see it in Zechariah's prophecy in Luke 1, 69 to 75. You see it in Peter's statement in Acts chapter 3, 24 to 26. This linkage of Jesus as the fulfiller of the Abrahamic covenant. And as with the Mosaic covenant, which I'm going to talk about in a little bit if I have time, the Mosaic covenant, the Abrahamic covenant, it finds its end or its goal in Jesus. You see, he supersedes all of these things. He's the fulfillment of these things. So here is this Abrahamic covenant that's traveling through history. Now, inside of that, we're going to get the Mosaic covenant. The Abrahamic covenant continues on. Christ is the fulfillment of that. He's the fulfillment of the Mosaic covenant. And through him, then, everything is spread out so that all the nations of the earth are blessed. But he's the fulfillment of that covenant. And as Gentry and Wellham say, he fulfills all prior covenants, quote, by bringing to pass what those previous covenants revealed, anticipated, and even predicted through various patterns, types, and instruction. So you see these covenants, they all point somewhere. They point to Jesus. You see it in the Abrahamic covenant. You see it in the Mosaic covenant. They're pointing toward Jesus. He is the fulfiller. That's what I tell you. He is the center of God's reclamation project. He is the heart of it. Jesus, the one who's redeemed us and the one we celebrate and love. All right, so the new covenant that Christ institutes that I'll talk about in a minute, it supersedes all. He fulfills them all. The new covenant supersedes all of them. Okay, let's talk about David. Jesus is not, of course, only the descendant of Abraham through Isaac, Jacob, and Judah. He's also the descendant of the great King David. Jesus is the descendant of the great King David. This is significant because just over 1,000 years after Abraham, roughly, and many centuries after Isaac, Jacob, and Judah, God further narrowed the lineage of the Messiah. He further narrowed that lineage by entering into a covenant with Israel's King David. In 2 Samuel chapter 7, and we talked about this, of course, when we were going through and talking about David. God tells David that instead of David building a house for him, you remember David wants to build a house, and God says, no, instead of you building a house for me, he was going to build a house for David, by which he meant that he was going to establish in David's line an eternal ruling dynasty. In other words, the right of rulership would always stay with David's family. Unlike Saul, you remember Saul had the kingship. Saul was ruling. His descendants would then come to the throne. What happened? God took that from his family line. He took the dynasty from Saul's family line and brought it into David's family line. But he tells David, I'm never taking it from you. I'm never going to take it from you. You see that in 2 Samuel chapter 7, and you see that in Psalm 89. The right to rule would never be taken from David's family as it had been from Saul's. He emphasizes that point in Psalm 89. You can't read Psalm 89 and not see God saying, do you understand? I'm not going to take it from you. Yours is going to be permanent. But God makes clear in 2 Samuel chapter 7 and in Psalm 89 that he would punish David's faithless descendants. So it doesn't mean that there's always going to be clear sailing and that they're not going to be punished, these descendants of David who were in rebellion. He makes clear, just tells him, I will in fact punish your faithless descendants. And you see that happen throughout Israelite history, but that's different from removing the right to rule from David's family. He never did that. Even in punishing his descendants, the right to rule always stayed with David's line. Now, Jesus is the immortal descendant of David who's been placed by God permanently on David's throne. He is the immortal descendant of David. You see this in, for example, Luke 1:29-33. But she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. For you found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and will bear a son. You shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David." Well, God promised you're always going to have a descendant. Jesus is the immortal one who sits forever on the throne of David. He is this one, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. So you have that, and you have in Acts 2:29-31. Brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David, that he both died and was buried in his tomb as was his day. Being therefore a prophet, David, knowing that God had sworn with an oath to him that he would set one of his descendants on his throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of Christ. Going to have an eternal, your line is going to be, says, okay, and you know how that's going to be? That's going to be, there's going to be, it's not going to be a continuing chain of death, somebody else, death, and descendant. It's going to be in the immortal one who knows no death. And this is in his resurrection, you see. Immortal, death no longer has mastery over him. So he comes, he reigns, he's the one. And so you see this covenant that God made with David functions as narrowing the promise, the line of this one from Genesis 3:15, this one in the promises of Abraham, through you all the nations of the world be blessed. This Messiah comes through Isaac, Jacob, Judah, David. And that's why you see the writers of the New Testament talking about David. Because that's where it's coming from. The Messiah is coming in that lineage. Now Moses, in between, okay, so we have the covenant that God made with Abraham. Let's say around 2050 B.C., that'll be close. You have that covenant, and you have the covenant that he made with David around 1000 B.C. Okay, so we got about 1,000 years there. Just think 2,000 to 1,000, roughly. In between those two covenants, though, God at Mount Sinai, after the exodus of Israel from Egypt, he entered into a covenant with the people of Israel. And you see that in Exodus chapter 20 through 24. This is around 1446, okay, so 2050,000, right about in the middle. God enters into a covenant with the people of Israel at Mount Sinai after the Exodus, after he's delivered them and brought them out of Egypt. He enters into that covenant. Moses was, of course, the point man for Israel. That's why this covenant is sometimes referred to or called the Mosaic Covenant. Well, it's a covenant that God enters into with the people of Israel through Moses. He's the point man there. But there's a lot that could be said about the Mosaic Covenant, and I'm just going to say what I can about it in the time that I have. But there's a lot. And see, this interests us a lot, I think, because this is one of the covenants that's in play when Jesus comes. Now, the Mosaic Covenant, it was an interim. It was a temporary, subsidiary covenant. Sometimes when I use words, people tell me, you know, I hope they communicate. You see, it's subsidiary to the Abrahamic covenant. It's inside of the Abrahamic covenant, beneath the Abrahamic covenant. It doesn't cancel or revoke the Abrahamic. It functions within the flow of the Abrahamic covenant. That's all that I mean by the word subsidiary. Okay, so it's an interim subsidiary covenant that's given until God's promise to Abraham began to be fulfilled in Christ, the seed. It's an interim subsidiary covenant. it specified the way in which the faith of God's people was to be expressed, the way the faith of God's people was to be manifested until Christ came. Its temporary nature is obvious. It's evident in Galatians 3:15 through chapter 4, verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 4 through 18. You can see in Colossians 2:16 and 17. Hebrews 7:11 and 12. It was temporary. It was always intended to be temporary. And so you see its temporary nature is obvious. And the fact that Mosaic covenant was subsidiary to the Abrahamic covenant and did not cancel that covenant, that's obvious here from what Paul says in Galatians 3:15 to 18. He says, brothers, I speak in accordance with human experience. It is of man, yet no one nullifies or adds to a will that's been ratified. Once you've got a will over here, that's it. And he says, now the promises were spoken to Abraham and to his seed. It does not say unto seeds as referring to many, but unto your seed as referring to one who is Christ. That's what I've already talked about. So I say this, the law, by which he means the Mosaic covenant, and this is one of the slippery things about law, it has a number of different meanings. Its most common meaning is the body of commandments that are part of that pact or agreement that is known as the Mosaic covenant. It is the stipulations, the do's and don'ts that form part of that pact. But here he's using it for the covenant. The law that came into being 430 years later does not cancel the covenant previously ratified by God so as to abolish the promise. For if the inheritance is based on the law, it's no longer based on the promise, but God has graciously given it to Abraham through a promise. Abraham, I got a promise for you. You're going to participate in the benefits of this through faith, through this seed. In between, here comes the law of Moses. He says the law of Moses doesn't nullify that prior promise. It is subsidiary. It's within that promise. It is part of that promise's outworking in this world. And so it's important, I think, to understand that. Spiritual life, salvation under the Mosaic covenant, it was by faith, not by keeping the commands. I hear this, you know, twisted so many times, and I don't know if this is a, that is not how people were saved under the Mosaic covenant. Always by faith. They were saved by faith. This spiritual life was the gracious provision of God, as always, the gracious provision of God bestowed on those of genuine faith, which faith naturally and inevitably expressed itself in what? In obedience. And in repentance at failure, including an offering of the prescribed sacrifices in conjunction with which forgiveness was provided. You see that, for example, in Leviticus chapters 4 through 6, Leviticus 17:11, Leviticus 19:22, Numbers 15. It was always by faith and mercy. But faith then was expressed in a certain way. And part of the way faith was expressed would be on sin, there would be repentance and the offering of the prescribed sacrifices. That's why Paul in Romans chapter 4, verses 6 through 8, Paul can cite David. David, who lived under the law, he can cite him in support of the idea that justification is by what? Faith, not by law. Well, if this idea about, no, under the old covenant, they were saved by doing and over. No. They were saved by faith. And faith manifested itself in conformity with God's expressed will for the people in that covenant. And so Paul can cite David. That's it, right? When Paul can cite David, who lived under the law, as an example of salvation being, justification being by faith, then you know that that's how it is under the Mosaic covenant. You can also see that's true. That's why Paul and the writer of Hebrews, that's why they can cite Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. By faith, from faith, or through faith. You see them both citing that. They cited in support of the idea that righteousness is by faith. The list of the Old Testament saints in Hebrews chapter 11 confirms the critical role of faith in pleasing God in the Old Covenant. Now, of course, the sacrifices that were prescribed under the Old Covenant, they were, of course, only a shadow of the atoning sacrifice of Christ, the sacrifice on which all divine forgiveness is based. You see that in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1 to 4. God forgave sins. He really forgave them. He forgave sins under the old covenant, the Mosaic covenant, on credit, so to speak. He forgave sins under the old covenant because Christ, who is the true and efficacious sacrifice, Christ is the one, the true and efficacious sacrifice to which all the shadows of the old covenant point. He forgave on credit, so to speak, because Christ is coming into the world. Christ was coming, and because Christ's sacrifice, because it's the reality rather than the shadow, these are shadows that are pointing to the reality. God forgave in the old covenant before Christ came because Christ is coming, but these are the shadows that point to his coming. And because Christ's coming is the reality rather than the shadow, the forgiveness that is available under the new covenant, it surpasses that which was available under the old, in that Christ does what? Utterly purifies, so that even our consciences are clean from sin. Even our consciences are clean from sin, that we might serve God in a greater state of intimacy. You see that in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 8 through 14. Well, what's this idea? What I think is at play is that it was known intuitively that the sacrifices of animals weren't efficacious. And so there was always this kind of sense that that's why they were an annual reminder of sins. It is only in the coming of Christ where I see the true efficacious sacrifice, that now even my conscience is cleansed, so I don't have that barrier to going to God. So you say, how can there be forgiveness and forgiveness and one be superior? That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's how I think one is superior. Because even your consciences are cleansed when you see the efficacious sacrifice of God the Son on a cross. You see, conscience even cleansed now as I'm forgiven. Okay. Even all right, though the Mosaic covenant, though it was an interim subsidiary covenant, which was given until God's earlier promise to Abraham began to be fulfilled in Christ, some Jews... I'm not going to be able to finish this, but that's the way life is. All right, some Jews, they gave this covenant a priority over the Abrahamic covenant. And they exalted this interim subsidiary covenant, which had a designed obsolescence. They exalted this covenant to the point, you know, that they gave it priority over the Abrahamic covenant, and exalted it to the point that the works of the law, the commands, the do's and don'ts that were part of that covenant, became the basis of one's relationship with God, and thus the basis of one's inheritance. That's why you get this idea, you know, to those who are confident of their own righteousness. So basically what you have is a distortion that comes into being. Under this Mosaic covenant, they're so wed to this covenant that they exalted it so that it superseded the prior Abrahamic covenant, which was a promise, which Paul said, no can do. You see? And so they wound up exalting these things, and they focused on the works of the law, and they came to see that performance, this is how they started to look at it, that it is my doing these things and abiding by the commandments of the Mosaic law, that is the basis of my standing. It is not by my faith. It is by my doing. And see, that is a death trap. Now, that's not all Jews. But there were clearly some Jews that went that way, and you can see that in a number of places. You see it in Luke 18, 9 through 14, Romans 3, 27 through 4, 8, Romans 9, 30 through 10, 8, Galatians 2, 16, 3, 2, 3, 5, 3, 10, Philippians 3, 2 through 11. You see this idea that clearly there were some Jews on the scene who had fallen into that trap. And they were at least in sufficient numbers to warrant these things being addressed. And so you wind up having some people do it. Now, the Mosaic covenant, it included the grandest and the most complete expression to that time of God's moral requirements. But moral requirements did not begin when God gave the law to Israel at Mount Sinai. Mankind was under moral requirements from creation. How can we look at the flood and not know that? How can we look at the flood and not see that there were moral requirements so that God could say, these people are wicked? There were moral requirements. Now, those requirements were not given by law. Now, what does that mean? They were not given as edicts, express, articulated commandments. Rather, those moral requirements were perceived intuitively or innately, which is what Paul means when he speaks of the law of the heart in Romans chapter 2, verse 15. You see, it's part of our being in the image of God that there is this moral sense that we have, and we are responsible for that. So God gave law to Adam. He gave law to the people of Israel at Sinai. But that doesn't mean there are no moral requirements in between. Of course there were moral requirements. They just weren't law. And see, clearly, like for instance, the idea, law is not necessary for there to be sin. That's why Paul says in Romans 2:12, for as many as sinned without the law. Transgression's a different story. Transgression is a violation of a law, an express, transmitted, communicated edict. That's transgression. All transgression is sin, but not all sin is transgression. But I don't have time to mess with that right now. Okay? But this is important to see that we have this idea that we have these laws. Now, some of the commands of the Mosaic Covenant, they were peculiarly covenantal. You've got this pact, and you have embedded in this pact all kinds of do's and don'ts, commands that you do. I think the rabbis counted up 613. All kinds of requirements and commands. Some of them, though, were not the universal moral desires of God. They erected civil and ceremonial or ritualistic amoral distinctions between Jews and Gentiles, probably at least in part to keep the people of God untainted by their pagan neighbors in order to help them serve as a witness to their Gentile neighbors of the blessed life that exists under God. So there were reasons why God was doing this to distinguish them from their neighbors, but not all of the commandments that are part of this Mosaic pact are the ongoing moral desires of God. And you can see that, for example, clearly in 1 Corinthians 7:19. Paul says, circumcision is nothing and uncircumcision is nothing. Keeping God's commands is what counts. Now, if you don't recognize this, you'll blow your mind looking at it. You go, well, look, circumcision was a command. Paul means, I'm not talking about those kinds of commands. You see, there's a distinction in the commands. Circumcision, that's nothing. That was a command. Keeping the commands is what counts. I heard that bell. Keeping the commands is what counts. I'm not talking about those kinds of commands. So you see that there are many commands that are part of the Mosaic Covenant that carry on, not because they're part of the covenant, that covenant is obsolete, but because they're part of the eternal moral desires of God that we see re-expressed. That's why Paul in Ephesians 6:2, he can quote, you know, kids, obey your parents, right out of the Ten Commandments. You say, what happened? I thought the law is no longer. The law as a body or a set of commandments is no longer. But there are these other things centered in love, which I don't have time to talk about. I heard the bell. I'd like to carry on, but I can't. Thanks.